very, very warmly welcoming Steve back in our midst. It's lovely to have him back. And indeed, he's going to be with us rather more than just today, but it's jolly nice that the first day of term of a new year, indeed, is being kicked off by Steve's visit, so that's wonderful. And I'm going to hand over to him straight away so that we can get stuck in. Great.
Thank you, Anthony, and nice to see a number of familiar faces and a lot of new faces. My name is Steve Pinker. I am a professor of psychology at Harvard and a visiting professor at the New College. My specialty is cognitive psychology. My specialty is cognitive psychology. That's the study of intelligence, reasoning, language, perception, memory, imagery, other intellectual faculties. Today I'm going to talk about one subtopic in cognitive psychology, namely concepts, the units of thought, and reasoning, what you do with those units of thought. So let's define a concept as a mental representation, a unit in the head corresponding to some pattern of neural activity. And we have two basic kinds of concepts. We have concepts for individuals, a particular book, a particular person, and we have concepts for categories, say the concept dog, or the concept leaf, or the concept table, which refers to dogginess or leafhood or tableness generically. Now, categorization is a fundamental component of human intelligence. It helps to make us smart. And often you can appreciate what a mental faculty does by imagining what it would be like if we didn't have it. And it's often fiction writers who are most adept at doing that by playing out in our imagination people or worlds that lack something that we take for granted. And here is I'm going to begin this lecture by reading a passage from a story by Jorge Luis Borges, the great Argentinian writer, of a fictitious man he calls Funes the Memorious, who in fact is loosely based on an actual neurological patient, but that's not the reason I'm introducing it. So here is Borges's description of what it's like not to have concepts for categories. Funes is a man with an astonishing memory. Now, we, at one glance, can perceive three glasses on a table. Funes, all the leaves and tendrils and fruit that make up a grapevine. He knew by heart the forms of the southern clouds at dawn on the 30th of April, 1882, and could compare them in his memory with the mottled streaks on a book in Spanish binding he had only seen once, and with the outlines of the foam raised by an oar in the Rio Negro the night before the Quebracho uprising. A circle drawn on a blackboard, a right triangle, a lozenge, all these are forms we can fully and intuitively grasp. Irenaeo, Funes, could do the same with the stormy mane of a pony, with a herd of cattle on a hill, with the changing fire and its innumerable ashes, with the many faces of a dead man throughout a long wake. Not only was it difficult for him to comprehend that the generic symbol dog embraces so many unlike individuals of diverse size and form, it bothered him that the dog at 314, seen from the side, should have the same name as the dog at 315, seen from the front. His own face in the mirror, his own hands, surprised him every time he saw them. Swift relates that the Emperor of Lilliput could discern the movement of the minute hand. Funes could continuously discern the tranquil advances of corruption, of decay, of fatigue. He could note the progress of death, of dampness. So that's a taste of what life would be, mental life would be like without categories as a way of appreciating something that we all take for granted, namely that we effortlessly lump appearances and individuals into conceptual categories. Okay, so what is a category? Well, there are two basic kinds of categories. There are what are sometimes called classical categories, also called Aristotelian, all or none, or rule-governed categories, associated with this stony-faced gentleman here, Aristotle. Those of you who came over from the lecture on logic by Professor Grayling were exposed to the way of thinking of the world that was first formalized by Aristotle. So what's an example of a classical category? Well, a good one would be grandmother, which can be precisely defined as the mother of a parent. Even number, another classical category, an integer that is exactly divisible by 2, or a bachelor is an unmarried man. So here is a simple theory of human psychology, that concepts are like definitions in the head. A concept for a category is a list of the properties common to all the members of a category, that is the necessary conditions, and only the members of that category, namely the sufficient conditions. Now, this sounds like it could be a good first approximation of a theory of human concepts, but in the 20th century, it was challenged by this man, looking vaguely like a deranged serial killer, but in fact, one of the most significant 20th century philosophers, Ludwig Wittgenstein. Now, Wittgenstein said that, in fact, that reasonable theory of human categories, namely a category is a definition in the head, actually doesn't work when you look at real categories that people talk about and think in. Take the category of a game. Now, the concept of a game embraces activities as diverse as board games like chess, card games like poker, games with a ball, Olympic games. What is the common thread? What are the necessary and sufficient conditions? Could it be that a game has to be fun and amusing and an opportunity for merriment and gaiety? Well, that doesn't apply to your typical chess match. Does a game have to have a winner and a loser? Well, there is solitaire or patience, where there's only one player. When we see a child throwing a ball against the wall, we could call that a game, even though there's no winner or loser. Or ring around the rosy, that won't work either. What Wittgenstein argued is that for most concepts for which we have words in our language, there are no common properties. Instead, there are different properties shared by different subsets of the category. So physical activity would be a property shared by baseball and the child bouncing the ball against the wall, though not by chess. A presence of a winner and a loser would be shared between baseball and chess, but not the child throwing the ball against the wall. Hard thinking might underlie both chess and solitaire or patience. And so on. There's no common thread throughout the category. It's more like the strands of a rope, none of which run the length of the rope, but each overlaps through part of the extent of the rope. So this pattern of overlapping traits is sometimes called family resemblance because it reflects the way the members of a family are similar to one another. And I'll illustrate that with a particular family, the Smith brothers of cough drop fame. Do you have Smith Brothers cough drops in this country? Too bad. This is a product that goes back, I think, 120 years. And here we have a hypothetical family portrait of members of the Smith family. You don't have to worry about the Smith family per se or the cough drops. It's just an example of any family and how the members resemble each other. So here we have one gentleman who's got light hair, a beard, and spectacles. This man has a beard and dark hair, but no spectacles. This man has no spectacles, but light hair and a light beard. Just like the members of your family, you can see how you might share a nose with your sister and a smile with your brother. It isn't that every member of the family has the same trait. This is the logical structure that Wittgenstein argued is true of human categories. Now, it turns out that many, perhaps most, of the categories that we can identify have this pattern of overlapping traits. Take the concept of the letter A. Here we have from a graphic design manual a set of examples of the letter A from numerous fonts. You can see that it is not the case that every A has to have two legs or a crossbar or a pointy top, but over the full range of typefaces, there are different things that different A's have in common. Take the category chair. Does a chair have to have four legs? Well, a wheelchair doesn't. Does it have to have a back? Well, we might call this secretary's chair a chair. Leading to a New Yorker cartoon in which a man brings a chair over to his collection of chairs and says, "Attention, everyone, I'd like to introduce the newest member of the family." Here's another example of how the concept of family resemblance categories underlies a little bit of humor. This is a comic strip. I don't think it runs anymore. Sometimes it's called Bloom County or Opus the Penguin. Is that carried in the UK? Don't think so. It's an American strip. It used to be. But again, that doesn't matter. Its hero is a penguin named Opus, who in this particular strip suffers from amnesia. And he has an identity crisis. He's told that he is a bird. And so he accuses the people around him. He says, "Conspirators, all of you, taking advantage of a confused amnesia victim. So I'm a bird, eh? I don't buy it. A bird is svelte and aerodynamic. I am not. A bird can fly. I cannot. A bird can sing. Listen to this. Yesterday, all my troubles seemed so far away." And his friend says he makes a strong case. Finally, Opus says, "Who am I really? Bullwinkle the Moose?" Well, this shows that even a biological category like bird is very hard to define in terms of a set of necessary and sufficient conditions. Well, what about the categories that I mentioned in connection with Aristotle that do have definitions, the classical categories? Well, even those categories, when you start to press them, you find that it isn't so easy to come up with a definition that actually works, one that corresponds to human intuitions about which members are in the category and which members are not. So take the category bachelor. Now that would seem to be a nice, crisp, clear category with a definition, namely an adult human male who has never been married. On the other hand, let's say you were throwing a party, there were a number of single women, and your friend asked you to invite some bachelors to the party. And consider each of these individuals as to whether they would fit the definition of a bachelor. So we'll start with Arthur. Arthur has been living happily with Alice for the last 5 years. They have a 2-year-old daughter and have never officially married. Now, according to that definition, Arthur is a bachelor, but clearly Arthur is not a bachelor in the sense that most of us think of a bachelor. Boris needed a green card. That's the term for an American immigration certificate. So he arranged with his friend Barbara to have a justice of the peace marry them so they could apply for citizenship. They've never lived together. He dates a number of women and plans to have the marriage annulled as soon as he finds someone he wants to marry. Now, there's a sense in which he really does seem like a bachelor, but he's ruled out by the definition. Charlie is 17 years old. He lives at home with his parents and is in high school. David is 17 years old. He left home at 13, started a small business, and is now a successful young entrepreneur leading a playboy's lifestyle in a penthouse apartment. Eli and Edgar are homosexual lovers who've been living together for many years. They would fit the definition of bachelor. Faisal is allowed by the law of his native Abu Dhabi to have 3 wives. He currently has 2 and is interested in meeting another potential fiancé. Father Gregory is the bishop of the Catholic Cathedral at Groton-upon-Thames. So you can see how even what seems to be a nice, clear, crisp definition starts to break down when you apply it to individual examples. So family resemblance categories seem to be quite crucial in human cognition. And here are some other significant properties of family resemblance category. I mentioned the family resemblance, namely the pattern of overlapping traits. Another one is that a family can often be characterized by a prototype, a hypothetical member who has the largest number of traits that run through the members of the family. And that prototype needn't exist in reality. So here at the center of this circle, we have the prototypical Smith brother. Now, he may not actually exist, but he combines the largest number of physical features of many members of the family, and it is plausible that when we learn and remember a family resemblance category, what we remember is the prototype, real or not, and we judge members of the category by how similar they are to the prototype. This might be a prototype of a bird. It's what you would find if you looked up bird in a dictionary. Now, in reality, there is no such thing as a generic bird. as Joe Bird. A bird has to belong to a species. However, when you look up bird in a dictionary, if they showed you a picture of a blue jay or a cardinal or a waxwing, that would be kind of misleading because some of the traits of a blue jay don't apply to birds in general. So what dictionaries often do is they show you a prototype, something that does not exist in nature, but that somehow stands for birdiness in general, Joe Bird. Family resemblance categories also have unclear cases, and mathematicians sometimes categorize characterize family resemblance categories not as classical sets from set theory, but as a different entity called a fuzzy set, a set where, rather than membership being all or none, each entity has a number, say, between 0 and 1 corresponding to its goodness or how good an example it is of the category. For example, let's take the category vegetable. I think most people would agree that a stick of celery is an excellent example of a vegetable, and a carrot and lettuce. But there are cases where it's just not so clear. For example, is garlic a vegetable? Well, it's got, it's a little bit vegetable-y, and you can roast it and serve it, but if you ask people, is a garlic a vegetable, they don't say, yes, it is, or no, it isn't. This fuzziness can even have political consequences. In the 1980s, when Ronald Reagan was president of the United States, and he was trying to slash government budgets left, right, and center, in order to cut the budget for school lunches while still meeting the American dietary requirements, his administration categorized ketchup as a vegetable. And so it satisfied the vegetable requirement at minimal cost. Again, another example of a fuzzy category that actually drives political controversies is a sport utility vehicle, a car or a truck. Now, in the United States, as you probably know, a large number, maybe a majority of vehicles are wasteful, gas-guzzling, carbon-producing SUVs. You wonder, why do you need a truck to go from your house to the shopping mall? Well, it turns out an SUV was categorized as closer to a truck than a car, and so it escaped a lot of the regulations on emissions that were applied to cars, so people were using them as cars just because the law categorized them as a truck. And if I ask you, is a sport utility vehicle a car or a truck, your intuitions are probably a little bit squishy. But since the law has to make a hard and fast distinction, the law often uses classical categories, there have been severe consequences. Evolutionary biologists have to think about unclear cases and fuzzy boundaries, even for something like a bird. So let's take this extinct creature, Archaeopteryx, which was an evolutionary missing link, found in the fossil record, but a kind of reptile that had feathered wings, but on the other hand, its wings had reptile-like claws, its head certainly looked like a reptile. As one biologist characterized it, it's a piss-poor reptile, but not very much of a bird. The acceptance of Darwin's theory of evolution would not have been possible if biologists stuck to the characterization of animal species as classical categories requiring necessary and sufficient conditions. And believe it or not, some biologists opposed Darwin well into the 20th century by saying, look, something is either a cat or a dog, a bird or a reptile. It's impossible for something to be 3/5 of a reptile and 2/5 of a bird. Therefore, the theory of evolution is conceptually incoherent. Now, today we recognize that that's a bogus argument, that in fact many animal taxa groups are fuzzy sets. Evolution is possible because over generations, the composition of a group of animals can change as there are variations that change in number because of selection, and so even biological categories are can be fuzzy. Or here's another example of a nation-shaking event that hinges on the difference between a classical and a family resemblance category. Did Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky have sex? Now, Bill Clinton, on having been accused of having an affair with Monica Lewinsky, famously said, I'm going to say this again, shaking his finger, I did not have sex with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. It turned out that they had engaged in fellatio, and the question is fellatio an example of sex? This, believe it or not, was one of the articles of impeachment of President Clinton by the House of Representatives, and he argued, no, it is not an example of sex. His Republican opponents argued that it was. Just to give you one more example of how consequential this is a blastocyst, that is a ball of cells that results from the after the fusion of an egg and a sperm, is it a person? Well, if it is, then when you destroy a blastocyst to extract its DNA, then you have engaged in murder. If it is just a ball of cells, well, it's no different than clipping your fingernails. Or what about a fetus, a group of tissue that does not have a functioning brain and that a woman may choose to abort? Whether you think that abortion is a form of murder very much depends on whether you categorize a fetus as a human being or not. And once again, there is no correct answer as far as biology is concerned. Oh, and just to show you how current this is a automatically generated email that I got a couple of months ago from the Democratic Party. And it starts out in a very personal style. Stephen, House Republicans, this is 30 years after the Reagan administration, are ramming through legislation this week to classify pizza as a vegetable for the purpose of school lunches. So the controversy lives on. Finally, one more feature of these fuzzy family resemblance categories is that you can have characteristic but non-defining features. That means traits that belong to a stereotype that typically are found in many members of the family resemblance category, but that don't necessarily have to be there. So this is a kind of prototype of a grandmother. I got it, this photograph, by typing grandmother into Google image search, and it came up from a stock photo agency. Stock photo agencies, by the way, as with dictionaries, will often try to find a prototype for PowerPoint slides in need of illustrations. Now, this kindly looking woman has gray hair, a kind of dowdy sweater, thick glasses. But I think most of you can appreciate that to be a grandmother, you don't have to have gray hair and thick glasses and so on. Now, many of these arguments came from on purely theoretical grounds from Wittgenstein and other philosophers who simply held up a number of human concepts and showed that it's not so easy to find crisp, clear definitions. Then a psychologist named Eleanor Roche actually went out and did a number of laboratory studies to confirm that our intuitive everyday concepts are closer to family resemblance than classical categories. So first of all, she showed that people really do at least agree among themselves on this strange concept of goodness of measurement. How good an example of a category is an individual? She asked people to rate on a 7-point scale how good an example of a bird is a robin, for example, where 1 would be excellent example, 7 would be not a terrible example or not an example at all. And most people agree that a robin is a really good example of a bird, mean rating of 1.1. Chicken, not so much, 3.8. What's a good example of a sport? Football, excellent example. Wrestling, meh. Vegetable, carrot, 1.1. Carrot is a prototypical vegetable, partially 3.8. Murder is the prototypical crime. Vagrancy, not so much. A little bit more interestingly, she timed people as they verified statements or answered questions like, is a robin a bird? Hit one key if the answer is yes, another key if the answer is no. If the bird is a robin, they were a fraction of a second faster than if the question was, is a chicken a bird, or is an ostrich a bird? A third way of underscoring the psychological reality of family resemblance categories is to look at child development, and you see that the first individuals that children use a category word with tend to be the prototypes. So if you trace the use of the word bird by a young child, the first animals that the child will pick out as a bird will be the sparrows and crows, not the chickens and ostriches. Now this sounds like the human brain is a completely fuzzy associator of traits, and that somehow Aristotle went horribly astray when he even posited classical rule-governed categories. But that conclusion, it turns out, is too strong. That it is more likely that the human mind has two different modes of thinking, that we can categorize things either as rule-governed categories or as fuzzy family resemblance sets. And some of the tension in arguments, in legal disputes, hinge on whether you're applying a classical or family resemblance version of the same category. And you can tell that these two kinds of modes of thinking coexist in people's minds because people can often, with some categories, go both ways. So you'll remember that I said that people can confidently give answers and give the same answer for questions like, what's a better example of a bird, a robin or a chicken? Well, it turns out that people can do the same thing for categories that have to be classical and rule-governed, such as odd number. People will say 7 is a better example of an odd number than 447. The reason is 447 has all those even digits that are kind of clouding your judgment. On the other hand, if you really think that 7 is a better example of an odd number than 447, then it could be said you don't understand the concept of an odd number. Because the concept of an odd number is really something that is that has a remainder of 1 when you divide it by 2, and it is anyone who eventually grasps mathematics knows in some sense that one number is just as odd as every other one. The part of the mind that allows us to say that at the same time as we have this gut feeling that 7 is a better example illustrates that there are these two modes of thinking. Or here's another example. How good an example of a female is a mother? And everyone agrees, very good example. What about a comedienne? Their people are give a lower rating. On the other hand, there's a sense in which a comedienne is a perfectly good example of a female, and female is not a fuzzy category in that sense. I'll give you one more example. When we develop biological intuitions, we get a sense of a species that is deeper than merely the surface traits that characterize the typical members of that species. And that tension, in fact, is put to use in culture and comedy and humor. There is a Warner Brothers cartoon sketch in which Sylvester the cat accidentally backs against a freshly painted picket fence and ends up with a white stripe down his back, and is then the object of the affection of the amorous French skunk, Pepe Le Pew, and much hilarity ensues by our knowledge that Sylvester the cat, even though he has all of the prototypical traits of a skunk, is not in fact a skunk. Even children can appreciate that, which is why they find this humorous, even though Pepe Le Pew is treating Sylvester with a white stripe as if he were a skunk. And grandmother, remember I showed you the prototypical image of a grandmother, kindly woman, gray hair, doling out blueberry muffins, affectionate towards children, and so on. On the other hand, if I point out that Tina Turner in her prime was the mother of a parent. One of her daughters had a child of her own. You don't have any trouble understanding that she really was a grandmother, even though she does not have any of the prototypical traits of grandmothers. So the bottom line is that it would be too simplistic to say that human categories are either rule-governed or fuzzy family resemblance category. Human cognition has the ability to operate in these two modes. I'm going to say a couple of final words now of why we categorize in the first place before turning to the second half of this lecture, which is on rationality and reasoning. Now, you might think that we categorize simply because we're a anal retentive species who just loves systematicity and order, and so we force the world into little boxes for the sheer orderliness and convenience of it all. But that would be to underestimate the key role that categories play in thinking, in making you smart. And what categories buy you, why they make you intelligent, is they allow the inference of unseen properties from seen properties. That is, if you can sense a few traits about an object, and you place that object into a mental category, then that allows you to infer that that individual must have other categories. That's a very good thing. That's a kind of intelligence. To be concrete, if it barks, it's a dog. You use one trait to put this individual into a category. If it's a dog, it bites, chases sticks, and lifts its leg at fire hydrants. You've been able to deduce all of this knowledge that you didn't observe with your own eyeballs. That's the kind of thing that categories provide to or bring to human intelligence. Well, this is a good way to transition from individual concepts to the system that allows us to go from one concept to another, namely reasoning. Before you begin to try to understand human reasoning, you have to make two major distinctions, just to clarify, just so we all know what we're talking about. As they say, so we're all on the same page. There are basically two major flavors of reasoning called deductive reasoning and inductive reasoning. You'll pardon the expression, prototypical example of deductive inference is the following: a syllogism like Socrates is a man, all men are mortal, therefore Socrates is mortal. There are two things that make reasoning deductive. One is it tends to go from the general to the specific, not always, but that's a general characteristic of deductive inference. And it's certain. That is, if the premises are true and you've done your deduction correctly, then the conclusions must also be true. Inductive inference goes in the other direction. Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle are all men. Socrates is mortal. Plato is mortal. Aristotle is mortal. Therefore, all men are mortal. This is an example of an inductive inference. It goes from a number of specifics to a generalization, and it is uncertain. It is probabilistically true, but it is not guaranteed to be true. For all you know, the next man you meet might be Jesus or Superman, and you might be forced to revise your conclusion and say, oh, I was wrong when I said that all men are mortal. So it is not certain. Scientific reasoning is said to be inductive because scientific hypotheses are always tentative and subject to revision, whereas logical and mathematical reasoning is said to be deductive. Now, here's another distinction. Before we even get to the cognitive psychology of reasoning, it's essential to distinguish a normative model of reasoning from a descriptive model of reasoning. What's the difference? A normative model is an ideal model of how one ought to think if one is rational. A descriptive model is so called because it describes flesh and blood human beings. You could also call it a psychological model. It's how people really do think. what would be an example of a normative model? Well, a normative model for deductive inference would be logic, introduced to you, to many of you, by Professor Grayling in the previous lecture. A normative model for inductive inference might be probability theory, the mathematical laws that govern probabilities and their implications. So here is a question. Do people, human beings, you and me, man and woman off the street, follow normative models in their everyday thinking and reasoning? Which is another way of framing the question, are people rational? Okay? Or was Mr. Spock right when he said that people are, to his befuddlement, often irrational? So a way that one can study this question, rather than just opining as Mr. Spock did, is to see how close human everyday reasoning conforms or fails to conform to a normative model from logic or probability theory. And just to give the answer away before I take you to it step by step, the answer in both cases, both in the case of deductive reasoning and inductive reasoning, is it depends. And I'll show you what I mean by that. So I'm going to now give you an example of deductive reasoning, where there's a normative model and a number of experiments that derive descriptive models, and then I'll do the same thing for inductive reasoning. So here's an example of deductive reasoning. We'll see, test your intuitions right now. Here is a logical statement. I have a set of cards. Every card has a number on one side and a letter on the other. And here is a rule. If a card has a D on one side, the letter D, then it has a 3 on the other side. Okay? If D, then 3. Now, what is the smallest number of cards that you have to turn over from this array to verify whether the rule does or does not hold of this deck of cards? And I'll read the cards to you. So we have one card with a letter D. Another card, you might even want to write it down if you can't see the screen. My apologies that the room isn't perfectly organized to see the screen. So you can just even write these four symbols down. D, there's a card where the visible side is F, a card where the visible side is 3, and a card whose visible side is 7. Okay? So there's a D, an F, a 3, and a 7. Those are four cards on the table. The rule is, if a card has a D on one side, it has a 3 on the other. Which are the cards that you must turn over to test whether the rule does or does not hold? Anyone? The ones with the letters. D and F, that's one guess.
Just D,
that's another one.
D and 3,
that's a third one.
Four.
Pardon me? All four, okay? All four of those answers are wrong, and I'm going to show you why. So this is an excellent demonstration of how our gut feelings, even in a very simple logic problem, are very different from what a normative theory, the theory of propositional calculus, would tell you. Okay, so the most popular answers, by the way, are D or D and 3. And the correct answer, which none of you guessed, is D and 7. How come? Wait a sec. How could that be? Well, let's think it through. Okay, the rule is if D on one side, then a 3 on the other. Do you have to turn over the D? Well, most people agree that you do, and indeed you do, because if you turned over the D and it had a 4 on the other side, that would falsify the rule if D, then 3. You agree? Okay, what about the F? Do you have to turn over the F? Well, let's say you did turn over the F. It pretty much wouldn't matter what number was on the other side, because the rule just says if D, then 3, not say if 3, then D. So even if the F had a 3 on the other side, that would not falsify the rule. The rule didn't say anything about Fs. It just said something about Ds. What about the 3? Now, as I mentioned, the 3 card is very tempting, and a large number of people say, yes, you have to turn over the 3 card. But now think about it. Let's say you turn over the 3 card, and it doesn't have a D on the other side. Does it falsify the rule if D, then 3? Well, no. Let's say it was G on the other side. The rule didn't say anything about G's. It just said if D, then 3. It didn't say if 3, then D. Now let's go to the 7. None of you said you have to turn over the 7. Now, let's say you turned over the car, the 7, and there was a D on the other side. Oh my goodness, the rule can't be true. The rule says if D, then 3. You have a card with a D on one side and a 7 on the other. And that does falsify the rule, but like the people here who volunteered, the majority of people fail to turn it over until it's explained to them, as I just did, and they say, oh my God, of course you have to turn it over. So this is a nice textbook example, works almost every time, of a discrepancy between a normative model of logic and a descriptive or psychological model. How do you explain the fact that people seem to be such crummy logicians? Well, there is a widespread phenomenon called confirmation bias. This is a flaw in the design of the human mind. Namely, when we come across a generalization, we look for, and we want to determine whether the generalization is true or not, then we look for examples that confirm it, whereas what we should be doing is looking for examples that disconfirm it. So if you are a liberal or a conservative, if you're a liberal, you read all the liberal papers, and you keep getting more and more confident in your liberal beliefs because you keep coming across all of these examples that prove the correctness of liberalism. Vice versa, if you're conservative, when you think about it, the papers that liberals should read should be the conservative papers and vice versa, but people don't do that. Now, I'm going to, having kind of slandered the human species and saying, like Mr. Spock, that humans are irrational, that cannot be the whole story. Because if we really were incapable of logical reasoning, how could any of us have ever invented logic? How could you ever even agree with me as I walk you through the argument and expose to you your own prior fallacious reasoning? If you were persuaded, if you did agree with me and could see why your first guess was wrong, well, clearly some part of you must be capable of logical reasoning. And indeed, in the right circumstances, people can reason perfectly logically. And I'll give you an example. Here's another problem for you. If a bar patron is drinking beer, he must be over 21. That is a law in all 50 American states. You are a bouncer in a bar, and you have to enforce this rule. Who do you have to check? Here are 4 people sitting in the bar. There's a guy drinking beer. Do you check his identity card to see how old he is? There's a guy drinking Coke. Do you have to check his identity card to see how old he is? There's a guy who you know is over 21. Do you have to look into his glass to see what he's drinking? There's a guy who's clearly under 21. Do you have to look into his glass to see what he's drinking? Okay, anyone? Which of these, you're the bouncer. Which of these 4 do you have to do? Yes?
You look at the guy drinking Coke and the guy who you know is under 21.
You look at the guy who's drinking Coke?
Yeah. Well, you see how old the guy who's drinking Coke is, and then you look at the drink of the person who's under 21.
Not exactly. Anyone else? Because you wouldn't really want to do that, because the guy drinking Coke, it doesn't matter how old he is. The law says that if you're over 21, you may drink beer, not you have to drink beer. Or a better way of putting it is, if you're drinking beer, you must be over 21. Anyone else?
Well, in the proposition, you have 2 parts, 21 and beer. You have to be over 21 and you have the beer, so you have to check the guy that's drinking beer, and you have to check the guy that's under 21 to check that he is drinking beer.
Yes, you have to check the guy who's drinking beer to see how old he is. You've got to check the guy who's under 21 to see what he's drinking. Now, in experiments that give people this test, most, but not all people, get the right answer. Now, what's interesting is the bouncer problem is logically identical to the card selection problem. There's an if and a then. There are all 4 logical possibilities of the antecedent and the conclusion. But human performance differs dramatically depending on whether the problem is stated in terms of numbers and letters on a card or a law that's enforced in a bar. Content matters. Now, by the way, this is a way in itself a way in which humans could not possibly be perfectly logical, because it's almost a definition of logic that it's the relationships among thoughts that hold regardless of content. It should not matter in terms of the truth of a logical deduction whether it's a D and a 7 or whether it's beer and being under 21. But psychologically, it matters a lot. And what it's, that helps to resolve the paradox of whether the human mind is logical or not. The answer is, with certain types of content, we are perfectly logical. With other kinds, with just pure abstract symbols, we really have to work at it. And a general rule of thumb as to what kinds of content turn us into good logicians comes from the psychologist Lita Cosmides, who did a variety of studies varying the content. Not just any old content will do. But basically, if the content pertains to a social contract, that is, rights and responsibilities, then people are pretty good logicians. That is, if the logic, the if-then rule is, if you take a benefit, you must meet a requirement. That is, if you drink beer, you must be over 21. Then that is what triggers a little logical rule in our heads that applies quite effortlessly. Probably because violations of the logical rule with that content are the same as detecting cheaters of a social contract, and we're good at detecting cheaters. To do that, we have to be logical, but it's not an ability that we easily apply to bloodless letters and numbers. Okay, so for the question, are people rational when it comes to deductive reasoning? Are people good intuitive logicians? The answer is sometimes yes, sometimes no, depending on the content. Now I'm going to pose the same question of inductive reasoning. And instead of asking, are people good intuitive logicians, I'm going to ask, are people good intuitive statisticians? Now this turns out to be one of the most best known areas of cognitive psychology. It resulted in a Nobel Prize for Daniel Kahneman, a cognitive psychologist who won the Nobel Prize in economics. Kahneman recently wrote a bestseller called Thinking Fast and Slow, and the work that I'm going to explain to you has now been applied far and wide, including to the running of government, the presentation of medical information, and many other domains. Now, if you pose the question, are humans good intuitive statisticians? The most general answer is not so much. And there are a number of infamous or notorious cases in which people's intuitions systematically flout the laws of probability. Example, misconceptions of randomness. And the most famous example is the gambler's fallacy. Some of you may have fallen victim of it. Many people lose their fortunes and ruin their lives because of it. So we'll take as an example the quintessentially random event, the flip of a coin. Which sequence is more probable? You flip a coin 10 times, you get heads, 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 then tails, 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 as opposed to getting heads, tails, tails, heads, tails, heads, 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 tails, heads. Most people say it's much more likely that you'll get the second sequence than the first sequence, although you can show that those two sequences are equally probable. The fallacy comes from thinking that a random sequence has to kind of look or feel random and that can't have any pattern. But any pattern is bound to show up sooner or later, and it's in the eye of the beholder whether any given sequence of heads or tails is a pattern or not. The reason that it's called a gambler's fallacy is that gamblers will often assume that, say, if in a roulette table the ball has landed in a red slot four times in a row, then if the roulette wheel is fair, it's due to land black next time. Or if you flip a coin five times and get five heads, the intuitive way of thinking is, well, gee, I know that coin flips are 50-50, so if it's five heads in a row, it's kind of due for a tails, isn't it? The answer is, of course it isn't. The coin has no memory. The roulette wheel has no memory. Every flip or every landing of the ball is independent of the previous one. And the odds on every single trial are exactly 50-50, regardless of how many trials have come before in one direction or another. Gamblers can lose their fortune because they think, oh, I'm going to put all of my chips on black this time. It's due for black. You follow that strategy, you're guaranteed to lose money over the long run. And casinos are guaranteed to make money over the long run. You can define a casino as a business that makes a profit because of human statistical irrationality. Another example is, in many sports, you have a phenomenon called the hot hand. It originally comes from basketball, where if a player has sunk a number of baskets in a row, you think he is up, he's juiced, he's energized, he's on a streak that's likely to continue. He's got the hot hand. Now, it turns out that if you actually count the number of hits or misses in basketball as a function of whether the previous attempt was successful or not, it's like coin flips. They are independent of each other. The hot hand is a complete illusion. Every attempt at sinking a basket has the same probability. But because of the fallacy of the hot hand, opposing teams will often double-team a player who sunk a number of baskets in a row, even though, in fact, he's no more likely to sink the next one. So the fallacy comes from a misconception of what randomness is. People think of our intuitive model of randomness is that it's a causal process, that if something is random, like coin flips, there's some force in the world that's trying to make the coin look random. And so if it starts to look too non-random, well, gee, that force had better play catch-up and make it look random all over again. And so according to this misconception, randomness compensates for deviations from an expected pattern. The reality is that the long-term odds of a coin being 50-50 come about because randomness dilutes a previous pattern because from then on you have no reason to expect that the streak to continue or not to continue, and that initial streak of made baskets or heads will eventually be washed out in the long run. It's not like there's a process that's actively trying to nullify it, which as soon as you think about it you realize has got to be nonsense. A second fallacy in human statistical reasoning comes from our misconceptions of risk. How safe, how dangerous, when you go out and do something, what are the odds that something bad will happen? A famous example is that many people are skittish about traveling by plane. They feel much safer traveling in a car, even though the statistics overwhelmingly show that holding the number of miles constant, you are much safer getting in a plane. You even have absurdities, I don't know if people do this anymore, but where families, say going to a family occasion, like a wedding, I've heard of families that deliberately will split up the family and fly on separate flights in case some of them are in a plane that crashes. It would be such a tragedy for the whole family to be wiped out that they kind of spread the risk. Then when they rendezvous at the airport, they all get together in a minivan and drive to the hotel, where they're much more likely to be wiped out. Nuclear power is something that for which there is an enormous amount of opposition, some of it perhaps rational, a lot of it maybe not so much, because if you, even with accidents such as Fukushima and Chernobyl, the number of deaths caused by nuclear power since the dawn of the nuclear age is a fraction of the number of people killed in coal mines and oil offshore platforms. The disease burden from nuclear power, from radioactivity, is a fraction that of the pollutants in the air from coal and oil burning plants. But you never have, or at least not until recently, do you have demonstrations against oil-fired plants. A new nuclear, no nuclear plant has been built in many years in the West because of the opposition. Genetically modified foods get huge opposition, despite the fact that every study has shown that they are harmless. And in terms of what people fear when it comes to coming down with cancer, the fears are completely out of whack with the probabilities. I'll give you a few examples. Actually, I'm just going to... I'll give you a couple examples. So for contaminated well water with industrial pollutants, the extra excess deaths per million are 0.001. The risk, extra risk of cancer of PCB residues in food, a kind of contaminant found in some food products, is 0.002. On average, people voluntarily incur a risk of 0.6 excess deaths per million from just the air in their home, simply because a good fraction of rocks in the Earth's mantle are naturally radioactive, and if your house happens to be built over that kind of rock, you're going to be breathing radioactive air. Comfrey herb tea has an excess rate of 0.03, brown mustard 0.07, raw mushroom 0.1, a glass of beer has an excess risk of 2.8. Now, why do we feel skittish about eating food with pesticide residues, but don't feel skittish while putting some mustard on our sandwich? Well, naturally occurring plants have all kinds of toxins and irritants in them as a defense against getting eaten by bugs. Nature evolves insecticides, and when we eat them, it's the same as eating a man-made insecticide, but we tend not to think that way. And perhaps the most salient example, again, this has, like many topics in cognitive psychology, this has real-world consequences, is the world's response to terrorism, particularly in the 13 years since the 9/11 attacks. Now, the 9/11 terrorist attacks killed 3,000 people in the World Trade Center and the Pentagon and the four hijacked airplanes. As a result, and this was considered an intolerable loss of life, but as a result, the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, which were directly triggered by the attempt to minimize terror, resulted in 5,000 American deaths, to say nothing of the British deaths, or for that matter, the Iraqi and Afghani deaths. But even if you only cared about American deaths, more people were killed in the response to terrorism than in the terrorist act itself. And indeed, if you try to cost out the actual risk to human life of terrorist attacks in terms of how looking at a data set of terrorist attacks and estimating how deadly they are, you realize how trivial a risk terrorism is. So compared to, so the worst year in human history for terrorism was 2001 with 3,000 deaths. No other year even comes close. Almost every other year since then, the death toll from terrorism is in the dozens, perhaps the hundreds. But in the United States alone, we tolerate 40,000 deaths in car accidents every year, 20,000 deaths in falls, 16,000 homicides in the United States, 3,000 deaths from drowning, of which 300 take place in bathtubs, 3,000 deaths in fires, and 24,000 cases of lethal accidental poisoning. But you don't see the government mobilizing and throwing billions of dollars and setting up entire new federal departments to prevent this far greater number of deaths from causes other than terrorism, which would be much easier to prevent than the few terrorism deaths. In fact, every year since except 1995 and 2001, more people have died from lightning strikes, collisions with deer, peanut allergies, bee stings, and a category called ignition or melting of nightwear than have died due to terrorism. And indeed, because after 9/11, in the 6 months after 9/11, people were very skittish about flying. The fear of flying was elevated. It's been estimated that because of the number of people who chose not to fly but to travel by car and the excess danger of traveling by car, 1,500 additional people died in the year after 9/11 because they chose to drive rather than fly. What's going on? What's the bug in human cognition that causes our sense of dread and fear to be out of whack with the objective statistics? The foremost is a shortcut of human thinking that Kahneman and Tversky called the availability heuristic. Availability referring to how available in memory particular examples are. And the rule is, the easier it is to imagine an example, the more likely we think that category is. So how likely are you to get eaten by a shark if you go swimming off a beach? Well, if there was a shark attack that was in the news that week, you think that the world is infested with sharks, you're taking your life into your hands every time you dip into the water. If it's been a couple of years since a shark attack, you don't worry about it. Another factor that pushes human risk perception around is whether the risk is subjectively controlled or imposed by someone else. When you're driving, you're there in control, driving the car, turning the steering wheel. When you're in a plane, it's some guy with a cap and a uniform. Even though, again, you are in much worse hands controlling your own fate, when you control it, for mysterious reasons, it feels safer. Anything natural is felt as safer than anything human-made, hence the dread of genetically modified foods, but no corresponding dread of comfy herb tea or mustard. And the devil you know is better than the devil you don't know. Risks that are familiar, that you've lived with for a long time, seem less threatening than anything that is novel. I'm going to recommend to all of you the book Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman, where he recounts his life work on the built-in biases and fallacies of human cognition and their implications for war and peace, politics, the economy, health and safety, everyday life, an astonishing array of implications of the fact that human cognition has built into it a number of bugs. But when the title, Thinking Fast and Slow, comes from a fact that I've mentioned a number of times, which is that we are not irrational across the board. Our fast thinking, our intuitive gut intuitions, display these irrationalities. Our more labored, slow, step-by-step reasoning can allow us to surmount them. That is the lesson that I hope you will all take away with. And because this is such an important topic, I hope all of you will read Kahneman's book. Thank you very much. Okay, so the question is, are these flaws and biases kind of inborn and will always be with us, or with enough rational deliberation and education will we be able to overcome them to the point where the normatively correct answer that we come about through slow thinking becomes kind of second nature? So as a species, no. Every baby that's born has to learn to overcome the same fallacies and biases. That is, Lamarck was wrong when he said that if you learn something in your lifetime, it somehow gets encoded in the genes and your babies are born with it. So we know that doesn't happen. On the other hand, the reason that I would argue that the reason that we have education is that we are capable of overcoming them if we have the right education. Every new generation of kids has to be educated. And I personally, and there's a growing number of people who believe that the top priority in education, especially higher order education like college education, should be in identifying the kinds of fallacies that the human mind is naturally prone to and developing the workarounds, such as logic and probability theory. I think ideally combined with the kind of psychology that I mentioned that makes us all cognizant of our flaws so that we know that we should not trust our intuitions and reach for these tools when we have to make a decision. This is a conclusion that is slow to occur to many people who should know better, such as pundits and columnists in the newspapers, who will often generalize wildly from one example, or will confirm some deeply held belief by looking for examples and not looking for counterexamples, namely the confirmation bias, or will who oppose something because it's novel as opposed to familiar. You see these fallacies running through cognition of politicians, of doctors, of newspaper columnists. I personally think the world would be a better place if more people were aware of these fallacies and of the ways of overcoming them. So it's kind of Sisyphean in the sense that every generation has to push the rock up the hill, and when we die and our babies take our places, they have to be educated as well. But an educated person can work around them, and that's what one of the things education should do. Yes? Yes, so excellent question. I characterize them as flaws. Did they once serve a purpose? Are they really flaws? And one can make an argument that it's anachronistic to call them flaws, in the sense that if you look at how well adapted a member of Homo sapiens is to a natural environment, a lot of these rules of thumb are actually pretty good. And they kind of make sense in a more traditional environment before there were statistical databases, before there was a discipline of logic, before there was a mathematics of probability theory. And there is an argument, I didn't have time to get into it, that these are kind of ecologically rational in the sense that a person in a historically typical human environment, a hunter-gatherer, a tribal person, would have done pretty well with these heuristics and rules of thumb. There aren't a whole lot of gambling wheels in a natural environment. And in general, most causal processes actually do have a memory. It's not the case that nature just flips a coin with every occasion. And so if you assume, well, it's been cloudy for 4 days in a row, the sun is due for to make an appearance, that's not a fallacy, because clouds have a finite area, they move at a finite rate, and indeed, if you've been experienced clouds for a certain amount of time, depending on the climate, it may not be a fallacy. It's only a fallacy in the case where you can know the causal structure of the environment, present it to people, and they cannot properly take it into account. The reason that I felt emboldened to call them flaws or fallacies, anachronistically, is that in the context of the modern world, where we do have data and branches of mathematics and logic that are available, from that point of view, they are flaws. But you're absolutely right that for most of human history, they were not flaws, they were adaptations. Yes, the question was, when does our slow, deliberate, step-by-step thinking actually become more normative and lead us to good conclusions? The answer is, simply having systematic thinking does not necessarily make you rational. There are all kinds of crazy, irrational, nutty systems of thought that are extremely systematic. They're systematic ways of leading to wrong conclusions. One might argue that many ideologies, many religions, many obsolete theories in science, like alchemy, are the result of perfectly slow, deliberate, non-intuitive ways of thinking, but they just happen to be wrong. So while rationally justifiable thinking is usually slow, the converse is not true. Simply being systematic is not enough to make you rational. Now, that might seem very upsetting. Well, how do you make it so that the systematic kind of thinking we engage in is likely to be normatively justified? And the answer is, you've got to try, debate, test your ideas, have a systematic understanding of free speech, open debate, criticism, falsifying beliefs. By doing that, you can, one hopes, over the long run, weed out the systematic bodies of reasoning that in fact turn out not to be so rational, and you end up with ones that really do conform to the nature of reality. A slow and obviously never completed process. This is, I mentioned it, one of the purposes of education is to retune our intuitions so that they become more rational. One could say that one of the purposes of scholarship, debate, literate culture is over the course of history to do the same thing for systems of thought that are slow but may not be correct or normatively justifiable.
So I should mention to everybody, by the way, there's a superb article by Steve on Arts and Letters Daily, a great website that you should all have access to, on the purposes of education. And in fact, you've exemplified some of the very best aspects of that. Steve's going to be back with us later on in the term. For the time being, thank you very much indeed.
Thanks,